Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents The Dance of Change, The Challenges to Sustaining Momentum in a Learning Organization by Peter Senge, Art Kleiner, Charlotte Roberts, Rick Ross, George Roth, and Brian Smith. With commentary by Peter Senge.
Welcome. My name is Peter Senge, and this is the Dance of Change audio program. Be careful if you're driving. This work and this material is going to be very interesting, and I want you to pay attention to where you're driving. But seriously, I'd like you to know that this material has taken us in the vicinity of 20 years to develop and a couple years to get organized and a pretty tough year to get it all written down. Now, of course, we're going to help you understand it in the next 6 hours. But don't worry, it'll be more fun than it sounds.
Look ahead 20 or 30 years. Given the changes expected in technology, biology, medicine, social values, demography, the environment, and international relations, what kind of world might humanity face? No one can say for sure, but one thing is reasonably certain. Continuing challenges will tax our collective abilities to deal with them. Failure to rethink our enterprises will leave us little relief from our current predicaments. Rising turbulence causing rising stress. Increasing disconnection and internal competitiveness. People working harder rather than learning how to work smarter. And increasingly intractable problems beyond the reach of any individual or organization. If you are an organizational leader facing this level of change, then you are engaged in a great venture of exploration, risk, discovery, and change without any comprehensive maps for guidance. Actually, for most of human history, intrepid explorers have set out on their journeys of discovery without comprehensive maps. The portolans and rutters of the European Renaissance, for example, were hand-drawn charts describing specific routes along byways and coastlines, often derived from the hasty notes of previous travelers. No one expected them to provide more than rough guidance. Sea and land alike were turbulent, ever-changing environments. Currents and wind patterns shifted. Vegetation evident in August might be gone the following March. Storms altered the contours of sandbars and shoals. Yet, however imperfect, maps and guides have been among humankind's most treasured artifacts, jealously guarded, often worth more than gold. The 16th century explorer Ferdinand Magellan quashed an onboard mutiny because he kept his maps hidden and thus made himself indispensable. Only he knew where to pilot the ships. Even today, in an age of satellite positioning and cellular telephony, sailors and fishing fleets still regard hand-drawn rudders passed on among family and friends as their most precious cargo. Not surprisingly, the first atlas makers, who gathered and collected those charts and notes into books and portfolios, changed history. Some, like the 16th century Spanish royal court-appointed pilot major, Amerigo Vespucci, were former explorers themselves. In Seville, Vespucci hung a giant wall chart where navigators sailing into port traced their discoveries. Less favored map publishers had to bribe sailors and courtiers or ply them with drink. Vespucci's efforts did not go unrewarded. He was credited for a time with discovering the Americas, and the Western Hemisphere still bears his name. Ultimately, however, the most significant atlas maker of his time contributed something more important than just a name to history. Gerardus Mercator, a Flemish mathematician, created a medium for systematically organizing diverse data into a coherent image of the Earth as a whole. He drew the first map of the world on a grid of uniform north-south, east-west parallels. Not just Europe and the Indies, but all of the inhabited continents could fit. To be sure, Mercator's world map was distorted. Greenland appeared almost as big as Africa, due to projecting a three-dimensional surface onto a two-dimensional map, and he placed almost two-thirds of the globe above the equator, an unabashedly Eurocentric view. But Mercator's framework enabled cartographers to gradually assemble the tales of many journeys onto one global picture. The grid framework ushered in a new era of scientific mapmaking. In this audio program, we hope to create a new way of looking at organizational change, a way to organize the diverse tales recounted by organizational change explorers into a coherent whole, so that you can hear them and draw guidance from them for creating your own effective organizational change story. Some people today are seeking the accelerating, visionary, or intelligent organization. Others, the innovative, living, adaptive, or transformational company. They try total quality, re-engineering business processes, boundarylessness, strategic alliances, or scenario planning. Or they seek to build learning organizations using our previous work, The Fifth Discipline, The Fifth Discipline Field Book, as guides. Despite all their different labels, common aspirations guide most of these efforts. They are trying to respond quickly to external changes and to think more imaginatively about the future. They want better relationships with less games playing and more trust and openness. They want to unleash employees' natural talents and enthusiasm. They hope to move genuinely closer to their customers. Finally, they are striving to shape their destiny and thereby achieve long-term financial success. The current literature on organizational change is full of practical advice and suggestions for achieving these goals, but it lacks a way to effectively organize many different insights and approaches into a coherent system. Like the Portolans and Rutters of yore, it can only describe one small slice of experience and not a broader terrain. In this audio program, we've tried to take an alternative approach, to develop a kind of grid in which any organization's experience with change might fit. Since no individual person has all the answers, we have tried to gather perspectives and points of view into one place that, when heard alongside each other, can help you find your own way in this new, unfamiliar landscape. Undoubtedly, there are flaws in our framework. Like Mercator's Eurocentrism, some of these imperfections may only become evident years from now as we see the flaws in our assumptions. But without better maps, it is extremely unlikely that organizational change efforts will ever sustain themselves. Each new adventure will be the first. We thus hope that over time, the framework of the Dance of Change will provide a starting point, enabling all of us who care deeply about building new types of organizations to become part of a common knowledge-building process, leading gradually to better maps and healthier organizations. The problem that draws us together is a simple one: the fact that most change initiatives fail. Here and throughout this audiobook, co-author Peter Senge comments on the critical forces and issues that make organizational change difficult yet compelling.
The work that led to the original Fifth Discipline had actually been going on for about 15 years when that book was written. At that point, there was a beginning of a coalescence of many different ideas and threads that led us to begin to articulate a very distinctive view of what organizational learning was really all about. In the years since the Fifth Discipline has been published, really to my amazement, and perhaps to the amazement of many of my colleagues at that time, the interest in organizational learning and developing organizational learning capabilities has increased dramatically. As a consequence of this interest, there have in fact been lots of people doing very serious work in organizations to bring about these sort of changes. About 3 years after the Fifth Discipline had been released, it became very apparent to us that a book of tools and methods, of practical tips and stories, a book of the community of practitioners talking to one another, was terribly important to give people a feeling for what was possible. That led to the Fifth Discipline Field Book. However, throughout this entire time, there were some companies that had already been hard at work in this area for 4 or 5 years, and today I guess you'd look back and say maybe 10 years or longer. As a consequence of these long-term experiments, gradually it started to become very evident to us that there were deep problems or challenges that naturally arose as one attempted to develop a learning organization. These problems went beyond just understanding tools and methods and techniques. These problems were encountered by people who had...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.